Hi, it's Dave. Welcome. Today, I'm joined by Puru Saxena. He is a retired money manager based in Hong Kong. On Twitter, he's been active in the fintech community with over 200,000 followers. And yeah, it's a great privilege to welcome Puru on the show. How are you doing?
Thank you very much. Pleasure to be here. I'm good. Thank you.
Awesome. Fantastic. So the background of this interview and discussion is Puru has been tweeting on Twitter that he thinks have already started a market correction, and we're going to be seeing that play out in the coming months. So I wanted to bring him on the show to kind of share his perspective. And first off, this is not financial advice. Everyone, myself can be wrong, Puru can be wrong. This is just two investors sharing our opinion and thoughts and having a discussion. So please do your own due diligence. But that said, I think it's fascinating to have an opinion on where the market is going and to discuss and work through those reasoning. So yeah, Puru, I'd love to dive into kind of your thesis on why you think the market has topped and why you think it's headed down and how far it's going to be headed down. Yeah, can you kind of share your hypothesis in kind of a nutshell here?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, basically, the reason why I feel that we are topping as far as the indices are concerned, and I don't know whether this is the top, we may have another marginal rally, of 10-12% or something going out several weeks, maybe a few months, or we may top out here. I don't have a crystal ball, so I cannot give you the exact timing of the top. But if you look beneath the hood, if you look beneath the surface and you actually see what's been going on in the market, more and more stocks are getting shot. A number of these high growth companies, they announced fantastic results for the recent quarter. And they beat the estimates, they beat the guidance, everything was fantastic. And instead of going higher, these stocks fell 15-20%. And this is, in my opinion, a classic sign that the market has actually discounted the best that can be seen for the time being. And one by one, a lot of the stocks are basically topping out and rolling over. If you look at some of the fintech darlings from the last year and a half, the Pelotons, the Teladocs, Rokus of this world, and some other names also, Zoom, for example. I mean, these are all work from home stocks, which peaked soon after the vaccines were announced. But more and more companies I find now, they're basically market caps are shrinking. And a number of the growth stocks, high growth stocks, are now already down 50-60%. Some of them have just started their decline. And the weakness, in my opinion, is now spreading to the broad market. And it is noteworthy that whenever tops happen, Dave, it's not a single day event. It is generally a process which takes several weeks to several months. Now, let me give you an example. In 2000, which is a couple of years after I joined this investment management industry, the Nasdaq bubble peaked in 2000 in March. I remember that distinctly. Everybody was extremely bullish about the Nasdaq and tech. Everyone was adding .com in front of their names. The companies would, announce we're changing our names to .com, and the stock would go up 50%, 80%, 100%. So not too dissimilar to what we have seen now. We have seen some insane moves in some of the SPACs, some of the hot sectors. We've seen craziness in the EV space. We've also seen some meme stocks go up and down like yo-yos, 300-400%, the AMCs of this world, the GMEs. So we've had a lot of speculation, which has taken place over the last year and a half or so since QE was launched. And the governments obviously sent checks to everybody in the Western world, and people weren't allowed to go anywhere. So what did they do? They took the money and they said, okay, I'm bored, I'm stuck at home, I'm going to try my hand at investing and speculating. So a lot of people became day traders. You've had, the Reddit crew, the Wall Street Beats and everything else. Nothing against those guys. It's entertaining and everything else, but we've had mass hysteria and participation. We have had an insane amount of liquidity being pumped into the system by the Federal Reserve, $120 billion per month since the COVID crash. So this has been now going on for 18 months, coming up to almost 2 years. And as a result of all this money which has been injected into the system, animal spirits have gone absolutely berserk, or at least they went absolutely berserk. And, you know, we saw some huge excesses in everything. The ARK ETFs quadrupled, quintupled in 1 year, which is unheard of. You know, even during the height of the tech bust in 2000 or the tech mania, I cannot recall any broad ETF or mutual fund sort of going up 5x in 1 year. Some stocks certainly went up a lot more than that, but that was a bubble and it ended very badly. And I have felt for over a year now that we were in an incipient bubble towards the end of last year. And earlier this year also, I was wrong-footed in the sense I thought that the party would probably continue until the QE was sort of going on. But obviously, you know, if you look at the money supply, the global M2, the rate of change peaked in February, March this year. And that also coincided with the top in the most speculative parts of the market, i.e. the SPACs and also the ARK ETFs. If you look at the ARK ETFs, they all peaked in February and we had the sharp breakdown. And they basically have spent several months going sideways and consolidating, which is typical of a post-bubble environment. And, you know, if you look at some of the ETFs now, the ARK Genomics ETF, for example, ARKG, that has now gone to a 52-week low. So it's basically broken that range all through the summer, which it was sort of bouncing along in, to the downside. And on cue, a number of the other ARK ETFs are also starting to go down. A lot of the high growth stocks have already been shot. And if you also look at the weakness now, the weakness is basically moving to the other parts of the market. For example, if you look at MasterCard, Visa, if you look at you know, Facebook, if you look at FedEx, you look at all these bellwether companies from different industries, they are not trading at an all-time high. The index is trading at the all-time high, but there is a lot of subsurface weakness or carnage. And this is a typical sign of the market basically topping out. And I think the Fed's sort of change in policy, i.e. they've started tapering in November, and they've announced to the market already they're going to taper by $15 billion every month going forwards. I think this is the straw which has basically finally broken the camel's back. And that's why we have seen some intense selling in various securities and cryptocurrency over the last week, 10 days or so. And I think the liquidity conditions are changing. And another thing I would like to point out in a post-bubble environment, if you look at the bubble formations of any mass hysteria going back 30, 40, 50 years, it has been very predictable. I mean, you have prices go up gradually first, and then they basically go higher almost at a 70 degree angle. So you have the trend and then the trend accelerates, and then you have the topping pattern and then it comes down and the bubble breaks. And then one of the hallmarks for every bubble is that all of them without exception basically gave back the vast majority of the gains that they had made in the bubble years. So I don't personally think that this is the end of the bubble unless the Fed basically changes its tune and decides to basically abandon the tapering program, and they come back and they say, well, look, we're going to just keep printing forever. That is a different scenario, in which case I think we're going to go higher again. But I think for that to happen, first we're going to have to see some pain, because it's going to be very difficult for Powell to basically, you know, turn around and say, well, now we're not going to do the tapering, because they're going to lose credibility. So it's like a chicken and egg situation. I think the egg will have to crack first before the chickens come home, basically. So I think we are going to see some pain, and probably we're going to see, if the Fed stays on course of tapering and ends QE, I'm fairly certain that we are going to see a deflationary contraction next year. That is already underway, and I think more and more stocks are eventually going to get hit, and ultimately I wouldn't be surprised to see an 18 to 20% correction in the S&P 500. Over the next sort of year or so. And I'm basing this not on my own whims, I'm basing this on history, because if you see what's happened since the global financial crisis, which is when the Fed started, you know, embarking on QE cycles, every time QE ended, all the Fed's balance sheet basically contracted, the S&P like clockwork fell 18 to 20%. So I am basically using history as my guide to see what might be lurking around the corner. I don't have any special powers. I've just done a bit more sort of homework over the last 20 years or so since I've been managing money professionally and now, you know, living off my investments over the last 6 years or so. So I just think that all the signs are there. And if you also look at the US dollar, which is also a barometer of stress in the system, the dollar was consolidating for several months and now is broken up above the 95 level on the US dollar index, and now it's above 96. So this is again another sign of stress in the financial system. I believe that, you know, over the next few months, if the Fed continues to taper and eventually ends the QE program, the dollar is going to strengthen even more, which is consistent with the prior QE cycles. And that in turn is going to break the commodities boom. And then we are going to get, you know, deflationary problems. And at some point next year, the Fed, after a meaningful decline in asset prices, is going to come back and try and rescue everything again. And I think that's when everything will rip higher again. But I first think that there's going to be some near-term pain.
Got it. All right, Puru. Awesome explanation. So what I figure we could do here is, if you don't mind, I'd like to make it a discussion and maybe go back and forth on some of your points, because you laid out actually a very articulate explanation of how you view things. So first, I mean, it's obvious if you look at the charts, look at the prices, Zoom, Teladoc, Peloton, Roku, biotech, you can name hundreds of these stocks that peaked in February are down like 60% or so. Now it's a bloodbath with certain high growth, you know, speculative stocks. So why would you say that this is the beginning and not, for example, something that the market has already absorbed? And what's the link to the S&P 500 directly? Like, for example, what if someone says, well, they're already down 60%, so the bubble has already popped? Like, what are you talking about? Like, the other stocks are much stronger. They weren't speculative stocks, right? Like, for example, a lot of these, you know, you're doing 100, 200, whatever times, you know, if they even have earnings, you know, the multiples are crazy. So you could say, that's a separate group of speculative high growth stocks that have popped already. What's the link to the S&P 500, which has more solid earnings? Why would that so-called bubble pop and, you know, drop 20% or so?
Well, the short answer, Dave, is history. You know, if you look at the S&P 500 chart going back to 2008, 2009, and I posted that on my Twitter feed recently, I annotated that chart myself, and I basically was curious several months ago how the QE cycle would play out. And what I found was remarkable. I found that whenever the Fed or any other major central bank like the ECB embarked on a QE cycle, the S&P basically took off like a moonshot. And when the QE cycle peaked, within plus minus a few months, the S&P topped and it fell about 18 to 20% typically after every cycle. So, you know, I've got about 12 years of history on my side. And one more thing which is a bit more concerning in this cycle, at this time around, is that the valuations are much richer than they were in the prior decade. You know, we've had a big run-up. The secular bull market in the US has been going on since 2013, which is when the S&P broke out to a new high after two failed attempts in 2000 and 2007. So we are sort of 9 years in this secular bull market. Valuations are stretched. And we have had the biggest bout of QE and tremendous excesses in the market, not just in, you know, the speculative high growth names, but across the board, because the valuations are pretty high. So, judging by the valuations, judging by the price action and history, that's what leads me to think that, you know, the sell-off is not going to be isolated to a certain segment or pocket of the economy. The strongest stocks, the strongest stocks with the best fundamentals, the best price charts, are usually the most risky at the end of a monetary cycle. You know, this is a lesson I learned painfully myself in 2008, because I did very well riding the commodities bull market from 2001 all the way up to 2007 or 2008. And then the banks started imploding and all the other companies started topping out. And only a handful of companies, the commodity plays, were strong. And I was naive then. And I thought, well, you know, these are the strongest areas of the market. I'm safe here. No. I was not safe there. They basically imploded. And I had the worst drawdown I ever experienced in my investment career. And basically, I looked again at the prior cycles, did more work, and realized that, you know, when you have a massive monetary cycle turning over, usually the weakness spreads to everything. Some stocks fall more than the others. Wherever you've had the massive excesses, those go down 60, 70%. The indices may go down, you know, 18, 20, 25%. I don't know how much the S&P will decline during this cycle. But, you know, the only caveat is if the Fed does a complete U-turn and decides to basically, you know, halt the tapering program and unleashes another round of stimulus, or some other major central bank comes along and prints more money, then, you know, all bets are off. But if the Fed stays on course, then I think we're going to see a decent pullback in the indices across the board.
Okay. So do you think, like you're saying, the S&P 500, you think it could correct 18 to 20%. Do you think Google, Amazon, Apple, like the FAANG stocks also would go down about 20%, you think, next year?
I mean, they're a higher beta play. At least in the prior cycles, they fell more than the S&P. I don't know how the market is going to react, but by and large, I think that there's going to be a decent pullback in pretty much everything. If anything, I feel, you know, the defensives, the consumer staples, the healthcare, the utilities and stuff of this world, they are likely to, you know, decline less in the contraction. But the higher the beta, the higher the risk, the more the excesses in anything, the higher any stock has gone up. In my opinion, at least, I think that's going to probably be under more stress and pressure over the next few months.
Okay. All right. Let's dive into this a little bit more. So with the S&P 500, and this is where it's kind of like the jump, you know, like if the S&P 500 is going to get hit, you know, let's say 20% or so next year. There are some who say that the S&P 500 is cheap. If you look at things historically, for example, the consensus earnings estimates for 2022 is about $221. At the S&P 500's price, that's actually a 21 times multiple off of earnings. And then a second thing is those earnings, that's about a 4.7% earnings yield. If you contrast that with the 10-year treasury at 1.6, you've got over a 3% spread, right? Which is actually very high, according to historic standards. Even if you look backwards with S&P 500 earnings for the past 12 months or so, around $200, the P over E multiple is probably about 23. It's not excessive per se. Where's the bubble in the S&P 500 if it's only 21 times next year's earnings and earnings yield is, you know, three times higher than the 10-year treasury yield for the S&P 500? Like, what's your rationale there?
Well, if you look at the trailing 12-month earnings of the S&P is now trading at roughly 30 times PE, which is historically very high. The 22 PE multiple, which you've just alluded to, that's going to basically materialize towards the end of next year if those analyst estimates are met. I happen to believe that the analysts are basically overshooting. We are going to see a deflationary problem in the first half of next year, in the first quarter or two. And because of sentiment and the amount of leverage in the system, and the fact that, you know, the monetary conditions, the liquidity conditions are basically tightening, my view is that, you know, we are going to see a pullback because the fundamentals are all well and good. But in the near term, the markets are basically driven by the Fed's liquidity. This has been my observation in the business for 20 plus years. And that's why, you know, there is the old saying, don't fight the Fed. And the Fed was easing. You know, in March, April, the Fed started easing. A lot of people who were looking at fundamentals and who were looking at the economy, you know, backward-looking indicators, they missed the run-up because they said, oh my gosh, you know, the economy is so bad. Everything is so dire. The world's coming to an end. And, you know, a lot of people kept sort of remain skeptical towards the uptrend in asset prices. And conversely now, because at the top, everything looks wonderful and rosy. You know, the economy obviously has to look rosy, otherwise you won't have a top, otherwise you won't have the excesses and the euphoria. And I suspect that over the next few months or so, we are going to see a decline in the global PMIs. If you look at China's credit impulse is now very low. So China has been pretty tight. And I think that we're going to see a contraction in the first 3 or 4 months of 2022. And I believe that's why the stock market is now beginning to discount the changes in the liquidity conditions, as well as the perceived sort of weakness, which is lurking around the corner in the real economy.
Mm-hmm. Got it. Okay. So it seems like, and correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems like you're basing a lot of this stuff off of the liquidity, right? The Fed is pumping into the system. As mm-hmm. the Fed pulls back liquidity, am I right to assume that what you're saying is that the Fed is the main driver of kind of, I'll ask this question. Is the Fed the main driver of inflation, you think? And of, let's say, rising asset prices? And as they pull back, you think the pullback of liquidity will tighten, money and credit, thus pulling back, asset valuation? Is that the gist of it?
Absolutely. If you look at, if you look at monetary history going back 100 years, whenever we've had an ultra loose monetary policy and, negative real rates and so forth, and when the Fed has basically, kept its foot to the metal, metal to the pedal, so to speak, we have had excesses in the asset markets. And whenever the Fed has tightened and, things have slowed down, and whenever the Fed has tightened too much, that has basically broken the party. That has ended the party. That is what has broken the bubbles. It goes back all the way to 1929. Most people think, the 1929 crash happened on its own. No, it didn't. It happened after the Fed inverted the yield curve. And then basically the Dow tanked 90%. And going back 50 or 60 years, the Fed's tightening or rate hikes have been the cause or the trigger which have basically ended the party every single time. Whenever we've had a major setback in equities going back decades, it has always been due to the Fed policy. First, they create the boom by lowering interest rates to try and revive the economy. Then things overheat. And then they try and take away the punch bowl at the worst possible time, because by that time, things are already slowing down. And that's what has historically at least caused the bubble to break or the bubbles to break. Now, everything may be different this time, but I personally don't bet on firsts.
Okay, so why is there rising inflation this time with QE versus in previous?
Well, there are two factors. One is basically the supply constraints. The supply chains broke with the pandemic. There was a lot of pent-up demand suddenly. People had, checks sent to them, and people wanted to spend money, spend on durable goods, buy stuff online. And the factories basically weren't functioning. The logistics weren't working because of the pandemic. So prices went up, supply and demand. And more importantly, this boom in commodities is due to the weakening of the US dollar, which was brought about by QE by the Fed. Whenever the Fed has embarked on a QE cycle, the dollar generally has gone down, and commodities are inversely correlated to the US dollar. And whenever the dollar goes down and you have animal spirits, people are speculating with fervor, they bid up the prices of commodities. That's what causes more problems for the prices in the economy. So yes, I would say the Fed is to blame. Before the Fed came into existence, the dollar was pretty stable. Since it's been in power since 1913, the US dollar has lost over 96-97% of its purchasing power, and that's because of the Fed policies. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I want to give a counter argument here, and we'll try to weigh this against, kind of your hypothesis. And the counter argument is that we'll divide it into two concepts. One is a liquidity pump. So the Fed basically prints money, boosts up, pumps up everything, the credit markets, asset markets, everything. And so this is one dynamic. A second dynamic, let's call it an economic boost. Okay, so the theory is with COVID, it forced people to go online in a way where the demand for online consumption and online services, everything online, grew tremendously fast, much faster than what was typical. And because of that, the revenue for these, you know, digital companies have actually gone up, you know, quite significantly as kind of evidence of that. And therefore, they're accruing higher multiples. And this jump or boost of the economy, and here's another kind of angle I've been thinking about, is what if our economy is actually more online and digital than we think it is? You know, I think typical traditionally, the digital economy is a small part, but what if actually it's more than the majority, and COVID actually just basically lighted a fire on the economy, the online economy, which was has become the majority of the economy, and the Fed, by printing money, just boosted that part of the economy even further to the point where we have just like an economy that's just hyper growing. And this is causing the increase of demand, increase in wages, the labor shortages everywhere, even like rent price increase. Like in previous QE and, you know, Fed interventions, we didn't have like rent increases as fast as we're seeing right now. Like some places are jumping like 25% in a year, like rent prices. It's like insane. So if there's actual like real economic growth driven by digital, let's say online economy and companies, even if the Fed pulls back, right, with their liquidity and monetary policies, couldn't we still see a robust earnings by, let's say, digital online companies like the Googles and the Amazons, the Apples? And is it possible we could see the S&P 500 actually fulfill these analyst expectations, right, of $221 next year, which is a reasonable 21 times earnings? So what are your thoughts kind of on that angle?
I mean, I think it's important to separate the business from the stock or the market cap of that business. Okay, these are two separate things. I totally agree with you that, you know, digitalization is real. You know, software, e-commerce, payments, video streaming, now the metaverse, EVs, all this disruption is real, and it has a long runway and massive TAMs. I buy into all of that. My reservation with this is that because of the enthusiasm and the free money from the Fed and zero interest rates and QE and, you know, lockdowns and so forth and the investor animal spirits, what has already been discounted? You know, that's the key question. You know, yes, the business revenue growth of these companies accelerated during the COVID lockdowns and so forth. But the world is reopening. So the year-over-year comps are going to come down this year and going forward. They're not going to grow at 100% every year. So, and also, even if we assume that, you know, a company like, say, Shopify or Mercado Libre announced 100% or 150% year-over-year revenue growth, look at what the market cap of Shopify has done over the last 18 months. It's not up 100%, is it? It's up a lot more. It's up maybe 5-6x off the COVID lows. So that's the whole point, that because all this has been well known and, you know, investors have embraced this reality, they have bid up the prices to such an extent that, you know, the market caps of these companies have become so large in relation to their current cash flows and revenues that it will probably take a number of years before a lot of these companies actually grow into their valuations. And historically, if you look at, you know, market history, you will realize that markets don't generally tend to go sideways. Either they go up or they come down because of human sentiment. You know, greed and fear plays out over and over again. That's why I think personally that we're not going to see this adjustment by simply, you know, the stocks going sideways for the next 4 or 5 years as revenues and cash flows catch up. I think that there is going to be fear and panic in the market again, like it has always been for the last 100 years, and these stocks are going to sort of shoot to the downside. And then when the Fed comes to the rescue again, then we're going to have the next hurrah upwards. But I may be wrong. You know, you never know in this business, but at least 100 years of history doesn't suggest that, you know, companies can grow so quickly in terms of their market caps and just drift sideways for a number of years. There is no precedence for that.
Got it. Okay. So another kind of theory I want to toss out to dialogue with your thinking here is, what if, like, okay, so I'll give a kind of a hypothesis myself. What if the popping of the Zoom, the Teladoc, the Pelotons, the biotechs, the 60% drop by a lot of these high growth stocks, let's say, yeah, there's a liquidity, like people are forecasting, you know, the Fed pulling back, they're forecasting a lot of the pump in these speculative high growth stocks that don't have a lot of revenue to justify, let's say the multiples. Let's say that the bubble or the air out of those balloons are fizzling, let's say, okay? But let's say there's another kind of type of stock, which is they have a lot of revenue. You know, they're not just like, you know, small revenue companies, but these revenues are growing in a good amount. And it seems like those type of companies haven't experienced the pop of the bubble yet, right? I mean, you look at the big tech, even for example, Shopify, in some ways, they have at least more revenue than some of these small whatever speculative stocks, even though it's, yeah, Spotify, I mean, or Shopify doesn't have a ton of revenue, but Tesla, for example, has like, they're growing, you know, revenue in large numbers. It seems like there's a dichotomy going on where if you don't have a lot of revenue and you're really kind of speculative, you're getting crushed in the markets. But if you actually can prove some revenue and some earnings, you're not getting crushed yet. Do you think those stocks will get crushed eventually too?
Absolutely. I think the operative word here is yet, because as I mentioned, you know, the strongest stocks with the best fundamentals, the mega caps, the large caps, the leaders, the liquid leaders, where all the institutional money is hiding, the hedges are hiding, the big endowments are hiding, they are the ones which get shot in the end. This has been a hallmark of every ending of every bull market. You know, I remember the 2000 tech bubble very clearly. You know, in I think in December or January of December 99, January 2000, before the market basically peaked, the small speculative, you know, the pets.com and all those other small companies, which were absolute dreams, pipe dreams, they basically imploded. And then the market just carried on going higher. And then, you know, the mid-cap growth companies started imploding and the market just kept going higher. And everybody ignored what was going on around them. And then eventually, you know, the NASDAQ got shot in March with the, you know, the big caps, the Microsofts, the Intels, the Amazons, and Cisco's of this world, they basically got hit pretty badly. And then people thought, hey, you know, this is just a normal pullback. And a lot of people basically piled in. I mean, fortunately, I was totally out of equities in sort of 2000, all the way up to 2003 or so. I was long, you know, I was short the S&P, I was long gold, I was long some of the other commodities. So I avoided that carnage, fortunately. I wasn't so lucky in the global financial crisis, which I got burnt pretty badly along with everybody else. But if you see, you know, what is going on now, Dave, is very sort of typical of how markets peak. They don't just peak on the same day. All the stocks don't just come down on the same day. What happens is that as the bubble sort of gets bigger and bigger and more mature, people realize that something is wrong. You know, when they see the stocks rising so much in a year, year and a half, 2 years, people with, you know, some experience and some market knowledge of market history, they try and get out of those speculative counters and go into, you know, the safer, larger cap plays, and then ultimately into the mega caps, which are seen as a refuge, you know, amidst the storm. But ultimately, the liquidity, you know, conditions tighten to the point and sentiment becomes so sort of negative, everything usually gets shot in the end. It's just a question of when. Now, I'm not saying that this is going to happen, because, you know, anything can happen in the world. Anything can happen in the investment world, especially because we're dealing with the future. But, you know, I've got, you know, 100 years of history on my side. Whatever I'm saying is not something I've basically imagined. I'm just repeating whatever I've learned over the last 20 years, you know, studying market history and studying bubbles and crashes and so forth. You know, if you look at the commodities bubble, you look at the Japanese bubble in 1990, you look at the TMT bubble in 2000. Before that, you had, you know, the Latin American crisis, and then you had the 97, crisis also in Asia before that. And then you have the big parabolic run-up in the emerging markets and commodities in 2007 and 8. That also imploded pretty badly. You know, we've had the bubble in 3D printing, which also imploded very badly. So whenever we've seen, you know, an acceleration to the upside with, you know, mind-boggling returns very quickly and prices rising at a 70-75% angle, the end has always been very painful for the you know, remaining holders. So I may be wrong, but, you know, 100 years of history suggests that things are going to play out the same way, because liquidity hasn't changed. You know, it's all the liquidity cycle. The liquidity is the horse, and asset prices and the economy are basically the carriage or the cart. The liquidity pulls everything, and, you know, human nature being the same, greed and fear, that's why you see, you know, extremes in both directions, both on the upside and also on the downside.
Yeah. I mean, I think the question mark, or the possibility, the area I think that your hypothesis could be wrong if it doesn't work out, is the area of the economy. Like, if the real economy actually is, like, strong, and you see really strong earnings continually into next year and throughout next year, and we actually do get, let's say, a $220 earnings off of the S&P 500 next year, that's only a 21 times, you know, earnings price. That to me seems like perhaps a scenario, if it does happen, that would counter, you know, kind of your hypothesis. But that all comes down to this question: is what's going on in the world right now, what percent of the economic kind of boom and activity is fueled by just the Fed liquidity versus real kind of like economic growth, let's say from a sustainable, let's say, move into, you know, the online world or companies that have sustainable growth, and that the S&P 500 can take advantage of that. I don't know, would you kind of agree that that could be kind of, if that happens, then, you know, there might not be a 20% correction in S&P 500?
I mean, it could be less. You may be absolutely right. You know, there's no way to know for sure, but I do know that the economy is cyclical. It goes up and down. It's not, you know, static. And changes in liquidity create, you know, booms and busts in the economy and human behavior. So I'm not calling for a recession next year, you know, although nothing can be ruled out. I think there is going to be an economic slowdown. There is going to be a deflationary contraction in some areas, such as commodities and some other stuff. And I think at some point, the Fed will, you know, listen to the cries for help, because people are going to be, you know, urging the Fed to do something. And at some point, the Fed is going to reverse course, just like it did in, you know, December 2018. Mm-hmm. But for that to happen, I think we're going to have to get to the pain point first. Otherwise, the Fed's not going to reverse course. You know, we had a 20% sell-off in 2018 in December. That's what prompted Powell to basically reverse policy, you know, around Christmas. And then the market took off. So that's the point I'm trying to make, is that for the Fed to basically reverse course and become loose again, we will have to first see, you know, a disinflation in the economy, the inflation rates to come down. We have to see some cooling off the economy. We have to see some cooling off in asset prices. Only then will the Fed sort of reverse course. If the Fed, if everything, you know, remains hunky-dory, there's no incentive for the Fed to come out and say, well, actually, we're not going to taper anymore, because then they're just going to be the laughingstock of the world. So I just think that the risks right now are skewed to the downside for the next few months. Sure. I'm not calling for like a global, you know, recession or an Armageddon in the indices. All I'm saying is that we are probably setting up for a decent pullback in the indices. And I suspect that if that happens, then some of these growth stocks are going to go down a lot lower.
got it. It's going to be interesting to see. I mean, it's in a way, it's very simple in a way where if the Fed is loose with money, then you know, things go up. If the trajectory is tightening, then you got to be careful in some ways, right? In the direction of the Fed. So I'm curious, what are you doing personally? You know, I know your overall investment philosophy is you typically hold onto your positions and then you hedge, but is this situation different at all? Are you selling like any positions, raising cash at all, or are you just hedging?
Well, basically I was hedged a few weeks, maybe a week, 10 days ago, I got hedged. But then when I saw their stocks basically, you know, coming off so violently despite very strong earnings, I basically increased my short position. So I basically sold short the ARK genomics ETF, which I think is the poster child of speculation in this cycle. And that's done pretty well for me. I've also sold short Rivian, the EV company, because I feel that the market cap is absurd, $100 billion. Now, if you'll see where Tesla was, you know, at that stage of its life cycle with zero deliveries and so forth and 50,000 orders, I can assure you its market cap back then wasn't $100 billion, was it? So, yeah, you know, if you look at the excesses now, you know, Rivian is a sort of $100 billion company, bigger than some of the biggest established OEMs, auto OEMs. I see that there is a lot of froth there. And if my assessment is correct, then I think there's going to be some serious deflation in the EV stocks. So I've sold short the Rivian. I've also, a number of my companies are scheduled to announce earnings in a few days' time. And in anticipation of that, I've actually raised some cash from those and, you know, raised some cash in my account because I don't want to sit through a 25-30% post-ER hit like I have experienced in some. So I've got some cash, but by and large, I'm still holding my shares and I'm short ARK G, ARK K, the innovation ETF to hedge my portfolio, and also Rivian. So at the moment, my net exposure is short. So I'm net short growth stocks. And I'm also long the US dollar index futures because I feel that, if the QE tapering continues over the next few months and there is a risk of trade in the market, then the world's reserve currency is going to basically surprise to the upside. So I'm long US dollars also. I've basically recently cut loose my, my index futures, which I was long because my stop was hit. So I'm out of that. I'm not long anything. I'm net short growth stocks and I'm long the dollar index.
All right. So if you're net short growth stocks, then, I mean, does that mean that your positions, your short positions in ARK, ARKG, Rivian, or your short positions on all that outweigh, are larger than all of your long growth positions, basically?
Correct. Wow. Yes. Okay. I basically sold short more than I'm long. So okay. My short exposure is greater than my long exposure for growth stocks.
And then how are you doing your short exposure? Are you just shorting shares or are you doing put options or what's your
strategy? I've sold short the common. I've sold short the actual ETF, the shares. And I use a trend following strategy, a systematic price-based trend following strategy to put on and remove the hedges. So I've done that. So far it's worked. But in any downtrend, you do get vicious bear market rallies. So, I'm aware of the fact that I will probably have to cover my excess short positions at some point, especially after a big smash over a few days. But I won't touch my, actual hedge because I don't want to be exposed in this sort of environment. So at the moment, my, mode is capital preservation. I'm not really looking to achieve a lot of growth. I'm just trying to, retain whatever I've made in this upcycle, thanks to the Fed's QE. Mm-hmm.
Why not just pull more cash?
I mean, that's a tricky thing. I've actually thought of that. And I think for most people, cash is probably the best idea because, not everybody has the time or energy or inclination to look at the long side and also the short side. I mean, I do this full time. This is my job, if you will. I think for most people, if they are not willing to tolerate a drawdown, then raising cash might be the best option. For me, I have raised some cash. I never hardly ever do that. But because this is the turn of the monetary cycle, as far as I'm concerned, and the price action recently has supported my view. That's why I have raised some cash in my account, and I've also put on my short position that I'm net short. But you know, don't hold me to it, because if the Fed does something different or the other central banks do something, and the price changes and the price behavior changes, I will obviously, you know, adapt what I'm doing with my own portfolio. But for now, as long as the Fed is still, you know, intent on trying to control inflation, and the Fed is hawkish, and you know, the price action is what it is, then I'll probably just stick with their current strategy and let the price, you know, tell me when to get out.
Got it. Yeah, I mean, one clarification is interesting is a lot of this stuff is probabilities. It's all like not 100%. This is going to happen, or this is going to happen. I think a lot of times people can misunderstand. Like, for example, they hear you, they go, "Oh, you're short." But I think what you're saying is, hey, there's a greater probability of this scenario working out. Therefore, I'm adjusting, you know, my bets. But something can shift very fast in one day that shifts the probability in a different direction that changes your decision. It doesn't mean what you said yesterday was per se wrong or different. It just means that the probabilities have shifted, right? And your decision making has changed, you know. And it's a game of probabilities in a lot of ways. No one knows 100%, you know, like exactly where things are headed, you know. Yeah, next week for sure. So do you use a stop loss? Let's take your Rivian short here.
Yeah.
So let's say like there's always a possibility it goes against you, right? Some point. So how do you manage that short?
I mean, first of all, I'd like to just make it clear that I hardly ever short individual stocks, but Rivian just looks so absurd to me, and the risk reward just seems so favorable for, you know, shorting. I actually invested or allocated 3-4% of my account equity for shorting the common stock. And I'm basically watching it like a hawk, because I don't want to be, you know, caught if the tide turns and you have like a massive rally, or, you know, the speculation returns, because my losses potentially are endless. So I'm basically trailing it with a moving average. And as soon as the price will go above, I'll be out. And when it goes back down again, I might re-enter again. So, you know, I'm not one of those guys who's going to bet against the market and say, I'm the hero and everybody else is stupid and dumb. You know, I'm not like that any longer. You know, I've learned my lessons over the years doing this for so long. And that's why, you know, you've got to be open-minded and humble in this business. You know, whatever I'm saying, you know, I'm not urging any of your viewers or listeners to, or your audience to, you know, believe whatever I'm saying. I would urge them to, you know, do their own homework, look at the price charts, you know, try and verify, you know, whatever I'm saying, whether it's true or not, and you know, learn to think for yourself. I'm wrong plenty of times. You know, I make mistakes sometimes. And when I am wrong, I think one of my biggest sort of skill sets over the years, which I've developed, is that I'm very quick to identify when something is going against me, and I have no problem whatsoever in, you know, changing my mind and cutting the loss and stopping the bleeding. And, you know, some people say, well, you know, he's, you know, fickle, he changes his mind too frequently, but I would rather do that than get married to my own views and my own beliefs and my positions, and meanwhile my P&L basically goes to zero. You know, so this is again a personal choice. You know, a lot of investors are more longer term oriented. They, you know, give more leeways to their companies and so forth. But I've realized that, you know, as soon as the fundamentals or the story changes with any of the positions that I'm in, especially if there is anything material, I just get out. I don't hang around, because from my experience, you know, turnarounds seldom turn. You know, more often than not, things just go from bad to worse. So I'm more flexible and open-minded maybe than most people on FinTwit. Yeah. But you know, it's just a personal preference and how each of us likes to manage our own you know, affairs.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it sounds like what you're saying is your kind of, you know, style is, first off, you're going to invest with the Fed's, you know, direction, right? You're not going to go against it.
I don't fight the Fed.
Exactly, don't fight the Fed. And then second, you're a bit fickle. Like, once a company, you know, does improve or their fundamentals change, like in a significant way, you're out, you know, you're not married to any company, right? Back to the whole shorting. So let's say with ARK-K or ARK-G, like, and Rivian, what kind of moving averages are you using for like a stop loss or, you know, to get out?
I mean, for the ARC, I use the 5 and 7 EMA cross. So at the moment, I define the 5 and 7 cross as bearish because the 5-day EMA is below the 7-day EMA. So the short-term trend for these securities is down. As soon as the trend flips to up, i.e. the 5-day EMA goes above the 7-day EMA, whether that happens tomorrow, next week, or next month, I don't know. Whenever it happens, I'm going to cover my hedge. I'll remove it.
Will you cover the whole thing, right when it crosses?
The whole lot.
Wow. Wow, I mean, that's pretty...
But for the extra shorting that I've done, I'm not even going to wait for the crossover because it's going to be too late by then. I'm doing this to make some extra cash. So this one I will basically sell if there is a massive smash one of these days. I'm going to cover the excess shorts then and then just sit with the hedge position one-to-one to sort of mitigate my potential further losses in case the market continues to sort of go south.
Got it. So you're, I mean, using the 5 and 7 day EMA, I mean, you're using some pretty tight, you know, stops. I mean, it could change pretty fast, you know, in a week, it could be very different, right? With the turn of the market, you can be out of all of your short positions very quickly. What do you do in that case? Let's say, you know, after a week, you know, things turn, you have to get out, but then let's say it goes back down. Are you ready to put on another short position? Are you
doing step? Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I simply follow the indicators. So if the indicators flip to up, I remove it. In a few days' time, if it goes back down again, I put on the hedges. I don't use my brain to try and analyze why, you know, price is heading north or south. That's sort of irrelevant. What I try and do is align myself with the trends in the market to try and protect my capital during adverse market conditions and make myself as market neutral as possible. It's not a perfect hedge because obviously some days my stocks drop a lot more than the ETF that I'm shorting. On other days, they basically drop less. So it's not ideal, but it sort of does the job.
Okay. So let me try to summarize your short strategy here. So generally right now, because of the Fed's constricting monetary policy, you're biased on short. You're trying to look for, you know, opportunities to protect your portfolio. And so on certain ETFs like the RK, RG, and some others, like once you start to see the 5-day EMA cross the 7-day, you're looking at that as a bearish trend. Therefore, you put on your short. But once the 7-day crosses the 5, then you're saying, okay, that's a bullish. So you pull out your thing, and then you'll wait until it crosses again to go bearish and put it back on. So it could be actually in and out quite a bit, right?
Yeah, I mean, typically I have sort of 5 or 6 or maybe even 7 hedging trades a year. And the reason why I use this short-term crossover and not a longer-term crossover is because when the market basically rallies from, you know, a big correction or a pullback, it goes up very sharply. You know, the natural tendency of the stock market or the bias is basically, you know, heading north. Basically, stocks generally tend to go up over time. By hedging, I am simply trying to, you know, lower the volatility and the drawdowns because, you know, I'm a retired guy now. I don't have any other source of income. I don't manage funds anymore. I don't have any newsletter or anything. I don't even, you know, have any consultancy work that I do with anybody. So I rely on my capital gains and my, you know, capital to cover my costs. And, you know, so obviously I'm trying to be extra cautious. And this is why I hedge the portfolio, because I don't want to be in a position where I, you know, wake up one day and my portfolio is down 50% or 60%. You know, it's not going to affect my life in any shape or form, but it's just going to be distressing. And if I can, you know, find a way to reduce the volatility and drawdowns, then why not? You know, all it takes is a few minutes in the morning to see where the crossovers were, where the moving averages were, and either I put on the hedge or stay hedged or unhedged and just follow the signals.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, that's interesting because, like, once, yes, things can always turn against us. So if it recovers in a, let's say, in a different direction very fast, you don't want to get caught. So if you have a tight, you know, indicator to get out, then yeah, it makes sense. I'm curious, like, have you thought about like different options to hedge a bit? Like, for example, selling cover calls or something, you know, during times to raise some income. Like, yeah, I don't know. What are your thoughts on different options? And the other thing is, where did you model or pick up this kind of hedging approach, you know, with the 5 and 7 day EMAs and, you know, just how you maybe are net short? Like, where did you get this kind of, you know, formula?
Well, I've actually spent a number of years trying to basically come up with the best hedging strategy. And I've looked at options. I've looked at all sorts of stuff, volatility strategies. I've looked at various things. And I've basically used a software, a quant software, to do a lot of backtesting over several months. And the idea came from a Tom Basso. He's actually on Twitter. He's world-renowned trend-following trader. And I came across him maybe 10 years ago, or maybe 8 or 10 years ago. I can't remember now. Around 10 years ago or so. And I remembered, I learned that he was actually hedging his growth stock exposure by hedging using his own trend-following indicators. And I thought, you know, that was a fantastic thing, because he was retired also. And, you know, he was doing this to preserve his capital. And I looked into him, and somebody else put me in touch with him. So I emailed him back and forth, and he was very gracious and generous with his time. And he basically, educated me on the psychology of hedging. And, you know, whenever I put on a trade for a hedge, and I mention it on, you know, Twitter, I don't even bother anymore, because, you know, people just criticize me without actually realizing the philosophy behind it. So for me, each single hedging trade on its own means nothing. You know, when I put on a hedging trade, I am not saying the market is going to crash 20%. All I'm saying is that the trend is down for now, and I'm respecting my system, and I'm putting on the hedge, and I'm cognizant of the fact that in the vast majority of the time, you know, 50, 60%, maybe even 65, 70% of the time, my hedging trade is going to, you know, hand me a small loss. It's going to be a whipsaw. But when the big break comes, when the big bear market comes, like the COVID crash or, you know, the 2018 decline, that's when these hedges really pay off. So effectively, what you're doing is you're saying that in the good years, when the market is ripping higher, you are going to sacrifice a few, you know, 100 basis points, maybe 100, 200 basis points, or 300 basis points of your gains by hedging, by protecting the downside. But when the tide turns, and it always does, when you have a big break in the markets, then the hedges are going to, basically the profits from the hedges are going to cover all those losses and then some. Because what happens is, if you do have a big break in the markets like we had during COVID, I was fully hedged and a bit short, and I was suddenly sitting with maybe 25-30% of cash, hard cash, from the realized hedging profits near the lows. And I used that cash to buy even more shares in my companies when they were super cheap. So, you know, the compounding really added up, and that's why my whole account was up 400% or something in 2020, simply because I was able to hedge in time and then use the money from the hedges, the profits, to actually buy more shares. So hedging is not me saying the market is going to crash. The hedging is me saying, hey, look, the trend is down for now. I'm in capital preservation mode. And, you know, a lot of people, the younger traders on FinTwit, they kind of, you know, say, oh, look, you know, this old fart sitting there, you know, he's hedging again. He's wrong. The market's gone up. Yes, that is the purpose of hedging. You know, the hedging is only profitable maybe 30% of the time. It produces losses 70% of the time, and I'm happy with that. You know, some people may not be happy with that. Some people might want to, you know, capture more money and more growth on the upside and lose 50, 60, 70% of their capital temporarily during a drawdown. You know, that's their preference. I'm not cut out like that. I don't like to lose money. That's why I hedge, and I'm prepared to, you know, give up on some upside during the good years.
I mean, it's interesting. I think it's important to note that, like, part of your hedging approach, it requires a lot of adaptability, flexibility, like timeliness. some people, I think a lot of people, when they get scared of a market, they pull out completely, and then they're too scared to get back in, and then the market jumps, you know, 20 or 30%, and they feel like they can never get back in, and then they're kind of like, they're in a worse position than before, you know, because, yeah, they weren't flexible, and they didn't move fast enough, they weren't adept. And a lot of it is, you have to pull out the emotions, you know, like, and I think what it sounds like with your system is, yeah, you're willing to, you know, lose, you know, a sum on the short term on a consistent basis to take advantage of the big downturn when it happens so you can raise cash and invest into bigger gains. But I don't know, for the typical, you know, average retail investor, I mean, obviously we're not giving advice, but it seems like, would it just be better just to hold, you know, a basket of stocks and not worry about the volatility, or is there a simpler way, you know, to hedge in a way, or what would you say?
I mean, that's a very tricky question to answer because everybody is different. You know, everyone's mental makeup is different. Everyone's investment horizon is different. Everyone's financial situation is different. So I cannot, you know, give you a single answer which is going to be suitable for everybody. Some people, you know, have a 10-year time frame. They don't care what the market does. If it goes down 30-40%, they've got an income coming in. They've got more cash flow coming in from elsewhere. They buy more shares. They don't want the headache, you know. And by and large, if you buy into great companies, Dave, you will make a lot of money over time. There's no doubting that. You know, if the companies are growing over time, you know, if the company grows by 20x over a 20, 30-year period, you will, give or take, you know, capture most of that growth as a shareholder in terms of your IRR. I mean, depending on what price you paid when you invested, what the valuation was, lower the better, obviously. But if you are mentally, you know, ready and prepared for a 40, 50% drawdown periodically in your equity portfolio, and if that is not going to phase you, and if it's not going to give you sleepless nights and, you know, heartburn, then do nothing. If you feel that, you know, you are not mentally prepared to, you know, go through a 40, 50% drawdown, and bear in mind, you know, if you go down 50%, it takes 100% to get back to scratch. It doesn't take 50%. That's just the way maths works, unfortunately. So if you are not prepared to go down 50%, then you can possibly raise some cash, or, you know, you can set like a systematic a stop loss. You can say, well, you know, if the price of my security or my ETF goes below this moving average or this level, I'm out. And then it goes back up again, I'll go back in again. I mean, I've done some back testing on this too. And, you know, the 150-day exponential moving average works just fine for this type of stuff, for the indices at least, and even the 200-day EMA. But 150-day EMA has done remarkably well for the S&P. So if, you know, your average, you know, viewer doesn't want to go through massive drawdowns, then they can just, you know, go long the S&P when it closes above the 150-day EMA or the 200-day EMA, just ignore everything else. And just all you do every day then is watch where the price closed in relation to the moving average. And if it closes below, you exit and you just go into cash. And then you wait for price to go back above those moving averages. And if you do that, or if you would have done that over the last 20 years or so, you would have basically done reasonably well, if not better than buy and hold, with a significantly lower drawdown. So again, it comes to a personal choice. You know, cash is probably a very good option for most people. Hedging is complicated, but it works for me. You know, so again, it depends on what people are trying to achieve. And I would say, if you're going to invest in equities, don't invest money in stocks which you might need for the next 4 or 5 years. You know, have a buffer. Avoid, you know, investing in your last penny in stocks, hoping that you're going to withdraw this money in 3 months, 6 months time, because you never know where the market will be in 3 or 6 months time. So just be a bit more cautious and conservative, and have a longer term mindset. You know, that's the only thing I can say on this subject.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. I want to go to some Twitter questions. Z2Dag says, who does Puru follow and consider to be reliable and intelligent on Twitter when it comes to the markets?
Well, I mean, the list of people I follow, which is a public list, you know, anybody who's interested who I follow can basically read from there and see which people I follow in terms of, you know, market timing and stuff. But by and large, you know, I don't really follow other people as much. I generally, you know, follow the price action of the securities and the indices and the breadth indicators, and most importantly, what the Fed is doing. And I obviously pay attention to what other people are doing, you know, on or saying on Twitter. You know, there's a lot of very knowledgeable, experienced, and smart investors and traders on Twitter who I respect a lot. So I do keep an eye on what they're saying and doing. But at the end of the day, you know, I basically judge what is happening in the markets based on price and not on anything else.
Got it. Emmett Peppers, a frequent guest on my channel, he asks, how much value does Puru place in technical analysis and why?
Well, I pay attention to technical analysis 100% when I'm hedging, because, you know, trend following is very objective. You know, there is no emotion in there, because price basically is a sum of all the hopes, fears, aspirations, all the knowledge, all the data of the entire market is in the price at that given point in time. So, you know, if you are using a strategy to hedge your portfolio, then it has to be objective. I cannot, you know, sit there pulling my hair out thinking, you know, whether this is going up or down. So I have to follow price-based indicators to basically tell me what the trends are doing. But in terms of stock selection, I don't actually rely too much on, you know, trend following or technical indicators. I look at the quality of the company first and foremost, the fundamentals of the business, who the management is, whether the founder is still involved, which industry is the business in, you know, whether the business or the industry is facing tailwinds or headwinds. What is the competitive position like? You know, what are the margins like? What is this company's secret sauce? All that sort of stuff. So my investment in companies is based primarily on fundamentals, but I do keep an eye on the price charts and technicals to see whether, you know, the stock is under accumulation or under distribution, where we are in the cycle, that sort of thing. But I never ever sell out of a stock based on, you know, hard stops based on technical indicators.
Got it. YK asks, early last year, Puru was saying markets will continue its bull run as long as there's no yield curve inversion. Why did he change his thoughts?
Well, I mentioned that the market in the sense, you know, the way I see the business cycle, Dave, I don't see the business cycle as, you know, peaks and troughs in the S&P. I see the business cycle as, you know, a recession to recession. That is a business cycle. And my comment toward, you know, the inversion of the yield curve was more in relation to, you know, a nasty bust in the index and the economic contraction. I still maintain that, you know, we're not going to see, or likely to see, I can't say we're not going to see, we are not likely to see a recession until we see an inversion of the yield curve. At least this has been true for the last, you know, 60 years or so. And any, you know, decline which comes along next year, I don't think is going to morph into a 50% hit on the S&P like we have seen in some prior recessions. I think, you know, we are looking probably at a 15-20% dip in the S&P, which will be a garden variety pullback in the index. But, you know, the growth stocks are a different story. And the reason why I, as I mentioned earlier, the reason why I am more sort of cautious about the near-term outlook for the next 6 to 9 months or whatever, the next 3 to 6 months, is because of changes in liquidity. And that's why I think we are going to see a pullback in the index, but I don't think it's going to be a recession next year.
Mm-hmm. Got it. I'm curious, what are your investment goals in terms of, do you have some like average, you know, year over year appreciation you're looking for, some type of goal? So like you want 20 or 20% average, or you want to double in 3 years, or you want to beat the S&P 500 index, or what's kind of your benchmark? What are you looking for in terms of your investment gains?
Sure. I mean, I don't actually set annual gains or targets or anything like that, because I know that, you know, anything can happen on a year to year basis, but with a 10 year horizon, you know, I hope to at least quadruple my money over a 10 year period, which is a 15% CAGR over 10 years. I mean, if I can't achieve that, then I feel that I've basically, you know, not done very well during that period. But, you know, 15% is what I shoot for. If I can get 20% annualized over a 10-year period, you know, if I can do that for, you know, 2-3 decades, that would be world-class, obviously. I mean, I've been managing my money now freely without any restrictions in my personal account for 6 years now, 5.5 years. And so far, my CAGR is about 52% annualized, but it's not going to, you know, maintain at that pace. That's just absurd. At some point, the CAGR is going to drop. And if I can, you know, finish my investing career, hopefully in 20 years' time with a 15 to 20% annualized CAGR, I'd be absolutely delighted with the result.
Mm-hmm. Got it.
Don't know whether that's going to happen or not.
Yeah, yeah. What keeps you motivated? I mean, you know, at a certain point, you know, have you ever been tempted to say, yeah, I want to take a break, a vacation, just a few years, not think about this, you know, at all, just stick it in an index? I don't know. I mean, yeah, why be so involved, you know, managing your money? And this takes, you know, every day you're having to look at stuff and make decisions. You know, I'm sure there's some type of level of stress, anxiety. I don't know how much, but why do you, you know, entertain it continuously?
I mean, it's just the fact that I love the game. You know, I'm generally interested in the business. You know, I love looking at new companies. I love the research process. And it's just like a mental sort of challenge at this point to, you know, try and do the best that I can, you know, in terms of my performance. And it's just like a self-fulfilling sort of goal, which I've set for myself, you know, to give me some sort of direction and purpose in life, apart from, you know, my family and my two kids and stuff. Obviously, you know, they come first. But apart from that, you know, this is just a personal motivation or a challenge for me on a day-to-day basis. And it is so interesting because it changes every day. You know, the puzzle is constantly shifting with so many different factors and so many different things. It just keeps me occupied and gives me a sort of purpose in life. And, you know, I could make a lot more money if I, you know, return to the investment management business, if I set up my own hedge fund, or if I, you know, took up one of the offers from people who have approached me to manage money for them, or even set up like a stock picking service and stuff. But, you know, I've got to the point now where I just feel that I wouldn't want to, you know, just manage my own capital and not be sort of, you know, answerable to anybody and just, you know, live a carefree, free life, and just doing my own thing. You know, I'm happy to share my thoughts on Twitter. I mean, it doesn't cost me anything. And if it helps other people, you know, that's great. But I'm not really looking to monetize anything. I mean, I haven't really thought about it at all. It's just something I do to sort of entertain myself and keep myself occupied and motivated and hopefully sharp.
Yeah, I hear you. Yeah, you know, it's funny because a lot of that kind of resonates with me too. I mean, there is something... one of the most, I think, challenging things to do intellectually is like investing, because it's so complex and there's so many moving parts. And no matter how much you study it, there's always so much more, you know, that's not like, that's still, you know, yet to be uncovered. And it's almost like a field that is endless in, you know, how it changes and, you know, the possibilities and, yeah, it's definitely fascinating. But I also resonate with you. I think there is an extra burden if you take on other people's money. The more responsibilities, the more people are paying you for services. Like, there's just complexity, and you know, for certain people, it's just not worth it. The complexity. It's just easier just to live a simple, kind of more focused life where you are in control of, you know, like your decisions and, you know, your assets. But yeah, definitely.
Yeah, I mean, I just don't want the responsibility at this stage of my life, you know, to be responsible for other people's money, especially retail investors.
Yeah.
I mean, if some opportunity comes along where a big institution says, well, you know, here's some money, we'll, you know, run our family office or whatever, then, you know, that's a different proposition. Or somebody says, you know, here's an institutional fund, manage this for us, you know, and if it's an interesting enough endeavor and if it's challenging enough, you know, I might consider it. But I don't really want to get involved in this whole, you know, managing money for retail investors, because, you know, they obviously don't have as deep pockets and they are more sort of concerned with the day-to-day swings and the volatility. And I just don't want that responsibility on my shoulders any longer, you know.
Yeah, definitely. I hear you. Puru, it's been fun chatting with you, definitely. I love talking about this stuff. We can go on all day. Fascinating stuff. Thank you for being open and available, coming on, sharing, you know, what you know and what you've learned in your investing journey. I'm going to go ahead and link to your Twitter profile in the video description so people can follow you. Is there any other kind of last things you want to say or, you know, direct people to?
Yeah, I mean, one thing I would say is, you know, in this business, if you're starting out especially, learn to think for yourself, you know, ignore groupthink, ignore the experts, including me, you know, think for yourself, think where the world is headed, look at, you know, what the Fed is doing. I keep harping on about this, but believe me, it is the single most important thing. Keep an eye on what the Fed is doing. Keep, you know, in tune with the major trends. Identify the best companies, the leading companies, which are changing the world, and hopefully buy into them at decent prices and follow some sort of risk management strategy, which allows you to sleep well at night. And, you know, when you do get these periodic pullbacks, if you are going to panic, panic early, not after the crash. That's the worst time to panic.
Yeah, panic after the crash. Avoid that. All right. Thank you, Puru. Yeah, fun talking with you. And yeah, hopefully we can talk again.
Yeah, my pleasure, Dave. Hope you enjoyed that. It was fun. Thank you very much.
Great.